God does not play dice. That is what Albert Einstein famously wrote to fellow physicist Max Born 100 years ago, 1921. God does not play dice. Now, let me read you a Bible verse about dice. This is Proverbs 16:33. A lot is cast into the lap, but its every decision is from the Lord. So, let us cast some lots. I have here a couple of dice. They select a value between 1 and 6. Let's see what we get. Oh, that's why we brought 2. 3. That decision was from the Lord. That's what Proverbs 16:33 says. So my question is, do you believe that? And if so, was that God's active agency or his passive will? Did God somehow reach out through time and space and alter the motion of the die so that it landed where he wanted? Did he subtly alter the motion of my hand so that I cast it the way that he desired? Am I being subtly mind-controlled by God? Or is God like the world's greatest billiard player, where long, long, long ago, through a single stroke of the cue, he struck at the creation of the universe, and ever since then, balls have been hitting other balls and falling into pockets according to his will, as if actively compelled, and yet he did it all with that single master stroke at the beginning, so that all through time and space, I always was going to roll a 3 because of that first perfect master stroke. That's what Morpheus believed. Or do you say, Tony, this is all crazy. God had nothing to do with you getting a 3 on the dice. The die picked 3 because that's what it does 16 2/3% of the time. The only agents involved in me rolling a die are me and the laws of physics. God has nothing to do with it. I expect that that would be the default view of the majority of people listening today. We don't go about our day interacting with the world thinking, huh, God is doing that. God is there. Hey, look, acts of God. Someone who acted like that would be a little bit strange, yes? But that is one of the differences between our worldview and that of the ancients. And we're in this sermon series, God and the Ancients, and we're looking at stories of the interaction between God and the ancient people of the Old Testament. And unlike most of us, the people of the Old Testament very much did see God's active agency in things going on all around them. All weather was attributed to God, for example. Every time the wind blew or the rain fell, they saw that as a movement of God. They saw that God makes the plants grow. God was the reason that you can put one seed into the ground and get an entire plant out. It is God who gives the increase. And when a die is cast into the lap, its every decision is from the Lord. God picked 2 this time. So I want to give a quick welcome to those who are joining us from Takotnu or online and offer you this challenge. If you've never thought about God being active in the very stuff of the world around you, I want to invite you to open your mind and enter this worldview of the ancients with me for the next 30 minutes as we journey into the story of Job. The first thing that we need to understand about the book of Job is the genre. Job is a wisdom book. The first 2 chapters are a setup story, and then chapters 3 through 41 are discourses, people talking to each other. And then finally, right in 42, it finishes the story, and that's the end of the book. An easy way to think of a wisdom book is that it's like a Christopher Nolan movie. Take Inception, for example. The setup of this movie is that in this world, we can enter each other's dreams, and that's being used by a group of con artists. Then the movie asks us all these deep questions about the nature of consciousness, whether we truly know that we're awake, where our ideas come from, the interplay of the conscious and unconscious minds, what it means for something to be real. It gets totally dramatic with layer within layer of dream and waking and story and philosophy all wrapped together into this action-packed story. And then in the end, the story resolves, but many of your questions are kind of left hanging. Is the top going to fall? Was he asleep the whole time? Everything that I just said about Inception is true about Job. But the story is different because the questions are different, and the question that Job is asking takes us back to our dice. See, we started asking questions about God's role in the dice, right? You know, and having some fun with how that would actually work, God changing the roles of my dice. It starts getting a lot less fun when we start adding stakes. If I roll high, because remember, it's God who's playing. If I roll high or low in a game, maybe I win or lose. But when we roll high or low in life, the consequences are more serious. Let's have a look at how we do. That's a four. Born in Romania to a middle-class family. Your parents don't split up until you're 13. Three. Okay. You actually never knew your dad. Oh, another three. Let's see what else we can get here. Six. Wow. Your dad is an architect and your mom is an astrophysicist and you live in Sweden. They love skiing in the Alps. Now, if the roll of the dice is random, it may not be a happy reality that we live in, but at least it's a fair one. Everyone gets to roll the dice, and the events come out the way that they do. There's no sense in complaining to a cold and uncaring mechanistic universe that you don't like what came up on the die. But what if it's every decision is from the Lord? How can God be wise and just and intimately involved in events, and the result is our world? That is the question that Job is asking. And so let's read the book of Job. I'm going to read this out of the Message Bible. Job was a man who lived in Uz. He was honest inside and out, a man of his word who was totally devoted to God and hated evil with a passion. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters, and he was also very wealthy. 7,000 head of sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 head teams of oxen, 500 donkeys, huge staff of servants, the most influential man in all the East. His sons used to take turn hosting parties in their homes, always inviting their 3 sisters to join them in their merrymaking. And when the parties were over, Job would get up early in the morning and sacrifice a burnt offering for each of his children, thinking, well, maybe one of them sinned by defying God inwardly. And Job made a habit of this sacrificial atonement just in case they had sinned. Here's the point. Job is a great person. He has been abundantly blessed by God. He has everything he could ever want. And he goes above and beyond the call of duty to make sure he's right with God in every moment. Then the story hard cuts to a new scene. We leave the earth, and now we're in heaven, in God's throne room, where God is ruling and reigning over the world. Let's pick it up in verse 6. One day, the angels came to report to God. Satan, who was the designated accuser, came along with them. So let's pause and take a deep breath together, shall we? What is Satan doing in God's throne room? If you have found this part of the book of Job particularly difficult in the past, you are not alone, and I have some good news. I do not think the picture that you have in your head that is so disturbing is what's going on in this story. If we look at the text in English against the Hebrew, the word right there is not actually Satan, Satan, it is Ha-Satan, the Satan. Now, in English, we don't use the in front of proper names, the Tony, the Scott, the Rachel. They don't do that in Hebrew either. You know where we do use the, both in English and in Hebrew? With titles. The lawyer, the defendant, the president. So there is strong reason to believe in this text that Satan is his job and not his name, which begs the obvious question, what does a Satan do for a living? Like, what's the day-to-day like for a Satan? Or a devil, which is what the Septuagint says, diabolos. The reason that that's hard for us to understand is that in English, Satan and devil are not verbs. However, both the Hebrew Satan and the Greek diabolos are verbs. They are things you can do. In Hebrew, to satan is to oppose, literally to stand against something. For example, in Numbers 22, God is not happy with Balaam, and so he puts an angel of the Lord in Balaam's path. In the English, it says to oppose him. In the Hebrew, it says to Satan him as an adversary, to be an opponent. That is what is being, what this being is that is reporting to God in his heavenly throne room. It is likely not the serpent from Genesis chapter 3, nor the dragon from Revelation chapter 20. It is a Satan, a spirit whose job it is to challenge things and poke holes in them and interrogate realities. We might say that he plays the devil's advocate to get the same point across. So let's pick it back up in verse 6 now that we've gone past that and we can breathe. One day the angels came to report to God, and Satan, who was the designated accuser, came along with them. And God singled out Satan, saying, "What have you been up to?" And Satan answered God, "Oh, I'm going here and there, checking things out on the earth." And God said to Satan, "Have you noticed my servant Job? There is no one quite like him, honest and true to his word, totally devoted to God and hating evil." Satan retorted, "So you think Job does all that out of the sheer goodness of his heart? Why, no one ever had it so good. You pamper him like a pet. You make sure nothing bad ever happens to him or his family or his possessions. You bless everything he does. I mean, he can't lose. But what do you think would happen if you reached down and took away everything that's his? He'd curse you right to your face, that's what." I want to make sure that we follow the action here. The Satan's job is to poke holes in things and interrogate realities. And God lifts Job up as an example of someone who not even the Satan, a designated accuser, could poke holes in the quality of his righteousness. He's a shining example. The Satan counters God with a surprising argument. Job's righteousness, he says, is counterfeit, because he already has God's blessing and protection. Today, we would say that he's privileged. He has wealth, health, education, family, power, respect, and it's easy for that guy to act righteously. There is an accusation about God's justice implied in what the Satan says about Job, that the blessings that Job enjoys, those are from God, right? And so the Satan is saying that the act of God having blessed Job has perverted that righteousness. He's paid Job off. So it's not real righteousness at all. It's mercenary. That's the Satan's argument. Very interesting. When we question God, we often ask how there could be a just and wise God ruling over the universe given the bad that happens. Satan asks how there can be a just and wise God ruling over the universe given the good that happens. So this creates something of a cosmic court case. Satan is the plaintiff. God's policy of rewarding the righteous is being challenged in court. And fine servant Job will find himself the unknowing, unwilling, and unwitting key witness in this trial. So God replied, "We'll see. Go ahead and do what you want with all that is his, just don't hurt him." And then Satan left the presence of God. So we cut back to the earth. In one day, Job's oxen and donkeys are stolen by Sabaeans, who also kill all of his servants. Then fire falls from heaven and burns up all his sheep and all the associated servants. And then the Chaldeans run off with his camels and also kill the servants. Then his eldest son was having a birthday party. A wind comes through, knocks the house down, killing all of his children in one go. He gets four messengers in a row, and each one is worse than the last. And now we get to see the result. We get to see whether Job had true righteousness or whether he was just paid off. Verse 20. Job got to his feet, and he ripped his robe, and he shaved his head, and he fell to the ground and worshipped. "Naked I came from my mother's womb. Naked I'll return to the womb of the earth. God gives, God takes. God's name be ever blessed." And not once through all this did Job sin. Not once did he blame God. We flip immediately to the next page. Next day, the angels show up. the Satan is there. They do the exact same greeting sequence from chapter 1. And then God continues, have you considered my servant Job? He says the same thing here about him being blameless and upright, but then he adds, and he still maintains his integrity, though you incited me against him to destroy him without reason. And like a young and ambitious prosecutor, the Satan does not back off and admit he was wrong, but doubles down. The Satan answered, a human would do anything to save his life, but what do you think would happen if you reached down and took away his health? He'd curse you to your face, that's what. And God said, all right, go ahead. You can do what you like with him, but mind you, don't kill him. And so Job is given terrible sores, and he's disfigured, and he loses his health. And at this point, the story of the cosmic court case kind of gets paused. And we zoom in on Earth, and Job is visited by three friends, Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar. Those are Job's three friends. And what follows is a series of discourses between Job and his friends. They begin disputing about what happened to Job and why. And so we end up with this earthly court case that is going to be the determining factor inside of a heavenly court case. And then in its context, the entire book of Job is actually answering a dispute within the biblical text about whether or not God plays dice between the book of Proverbs and the book of Ecclesiastes. So it's like a court case inside of a court case inside of a court case, and now you see why I say this is like Inception. I found a wonderful summary of from a scholar named Matisyahu Tzavat on this earthly court case between Job and his friends. He says that it centers around three statements, only two of which can be true. Here they are. God is just and good. God's character compels him to always act justly and for the good of others. The retribution principle, that God has ordered the world so that good deeds are rewarded and evil deeds are punished. After all, what else would it mean for God to rule justly? And Job's innocence. Job has done nothing to deserve his suffering. These three statements, only two can be true. The friends, Zophar, Bildad, and Eliphaz, insist that it has to be number one and number two. Obviously, God is just and good. Who could say otherwise? And obviously, what that means is that he rewards the righteous and punishes the wicked. Again, what else could God ruling justly mean? And so they conclude that the one that has to be false is number three. Job, you are not innocent. Regardless of what you think, the fact that God has cursed you in this way means that you are guilty. Job, on the other hand, holds that his innocence is the given that has to be true. He knows that that one is true. He also believes in the retribution principle, that if God rules the world justly and fairly, if he directs the dice, then the wicked should be punished and the righteous should prosper. And so the horrifying realization, possibility that Job starts playing with in his grief and his sorrow over this unbelievable loss is that maybe the lie is number one. This may have been written thousands of years ago, but it could not be more relevant today. They might be discussing this in abstract and philosophical terms, but this is the heart cry of every person who has ever questioned the justice of God. I heard a podcast recently with a prominent, formerly Christian musician about why they had lost their faith, and they told of a trip to Africa where they saw impoverished children dying of preventable diseases. And he said, see there, God is not loving and just. Or in his case, God is not real. Same effect. That is the same logic chain that is climbed by Job and his friends. This artist knew the innocence of the children, and he knows what justice is. He knows what wisdom is and what it would look like if it were in operation. It is not that way. Therefore, God is not just and good. So what happens is that 27 chapters in Job, 27 chapters we go around and around and around, arguing about whether one is false, that God is not really good, or three is false, that Job is not really innocent. The irony of this whole thing is that we, as the omniscient readers, know the answer the entire time. We know about the challenge to God's policy of blessing the righteous of humankind. We know that what is really happening is that God trusts Job so much that he wagers the blessing of all mankind on Job's faithfulness and his character. That's the real reason. Number one is true. Number three is true. And so the statement that is false must be. And it's at this moment that the conversations stop and we get to chapter 28. And chapter 28 is like an omniscient narrator interlude. It's this poem about wisdom. Where can wisdom be found? And it compares wisdom to silver and gold and gemstones. It says you have to seek it out in the little creek beds and find it where it lies and get little nuggets of wisdom. And that's how you find wisdom. And after we've had this little song about wisdom, a new character speaks. And his name is Elihu. And Elihu is a young man, and he says, I have listened to you old men and your old ideas, thinking that in age there would be found wisdom, but I haven't found it. No one has answered Job, and so I, the young man, will bring a new idea. He says, God is good. Number one is clearly true. In fact, Job, you're getting pretty close to the line there, buddy. And if you say that God, that you are truly innocent, then perhaps it is number two, the retribution principle that needs more examination. Maybe number two is false. We never get to learn what Job thinks of that idea because as soon as Elihu finishes speaking, there's a new witness to take the stand. God himself arrives to answer Job. What will God say? God never breathes a word about a court case or a Satan, any of it. Instead, he questions Job, and his questions are all rhetorical, and in his questioning, he takes Job on this tour of the universe. He starts asking, where was Job when he laid the foundations of the earth? What was his role in defining the limits of the sea? You know, these big questions, on and on it goes. Here's what I want you to see the next time you read Job 38. God's questioning here demonstrates a theological concept, the transcendence and immanence of God. The transcendence and immanence of God. The transcendence of God means that God is overwhelmingly huge and above and beyond all things. Look at verses 31 through 33. Can you bind the chains of the Pleiades, that's a constellation, or loosen Orion's belt? Can you bring forth the constellations in their seasons, or lead out the bear with its cubs? Do you know the laws of the heavens? Can you set up God's dominion over the earth? God says, I maintain the stars in their courses. If you or I wanted to loosen Orion's belt, we would have to leave here and travel at 186,000 miles per second, not per hour, 186,000 miles per second for 1,000 years to reach Orion's belt. God says, Job, while you and I are having this conversation, I am actively holding that thing in its course at the same time. God is outside and above and beyond and around and throughout the entire physical universe, and he can act on any or all parts of it simultaneously. That is the transcendence of God. Then this is followed by a description that demonstrates the immanence of God. Look at verse 39. Do you hunt the prey for the lioness and satisfy the hunger of the lions when they crouch in their dens or lie in wait in a thicket? Who provides food for the raven when its young cry out to God and wander about for lack of food? God says that he is on the savanna hunting with the lionesses. God says that he is actively participating in lion society. Lions, having not sinned, may still be able to hear the voice of God as you or I would hear a voice. We wouldn't know. It may be that God shut the mouths of the lions in Daniel's den simply because he has a great reputation with lions. Then he goes into a description of birth. Do you know when the mountain goats give birth? Do you watch when the doe bears her fawn? Do you count the months till they bear? Do you know the time till they give birth? I know exactly the experience that he's describing here, because I am father to 5 children. I know what it is to count the months and to watch as they bear. God asks Job, do you experience the tension and the anticipation and the joy and the exultation and the pride of fatherhood every time a baby goat is born? Because I do. The doctrine of God's immanence says that while he built and maintains the universe, he is not a cold, impersonal supercomputer. He did so out of an abundance of love for the joy of being God the Father to every baby goat. When we suffer, it is easier to believe in the transcendence of God than in the immanence of God. It's easier to believe that God hung the stars in the sky than it is to believe that he's there with you right now, wherever you are. God says, I never abandon so much as a raven. Jesus says that God consciously knows the number of hairs on your head right now, as well as the deepest desires of your heart. Now, as I give this description of God, there are 3 kinds of people listening. People who already believe this about God. You believe that God holds the stars in the sky, and you believe in God's presence with you wherever you are right now. Fantastic. There are also people who do not believe this about God, maybe don't even believe in God, and are not going to be convinced by anything I say today. Welcome. Thank you for joining us. And there's a 3rd category. People who would love to believe in a God like this, but who find it very, very challenging for one of 2 reasons that we're going to tackle out of Job. First reason, you find it hard to believe in such a God given what we know of science. We know what holds the stars in their orbits. It's universal gravitation. To think about God moving planets is really hard when we know how planets move. When I drop this die into the tower, I mean, it may look random to me, but that's just because I'm a slow human with a dumb brain, right? The moment I let go of that thing, physics takes over. It's at a specific angle, it has a specific amount of force, it's going to bounce a certain way, and it was going to do that the moment I let go of the die. The thing just runs its course. There is nothing but poetry to Proverbs 16:33. So, I'd love to see this omnipresent God, but I just can't square it with science. Allow me to help. See, this worldview that I've been speaking out of for the last couple of minutes is known as materialism. It is the idea that stuff, material stuff, this stuff, is the foundational root underlying level of reality. Everything comes out of this. So you can have something like love, which isn't stuff, but it comes out of your brain, which is stuff, right? Stuff is always at the bottom. That's materialism. And ever since the apple fell on Sir Isaac Newton and he realized universal gravitation, we have begun to think about the world mechanistically or deterministically. It's like our God is the perfect billiard player example from the beginning, right? One ball hits another ball hits another ball. The common name for this is the clockwork universe. That the universe is like a giant old grandfather clock, and each part moves because it's pushed by another part, not because it's operated upon by God in any way. If that is your view of the universe, I need to tell you, that fell apart in science about 100 years ago, which takes us back to what Albert Einstein was freaking out about when he wrote to Max Born that God does not play dice. He was talking about the emerging theory of quantum mechanics, for which Werner Heisenberg won the 1932 Nobel Prize in Physics. Quantum mechanics describes how atoms and subatomic particles behave, very little things. Heisenberg understood why Einstein was panicking. Listen to this quote from Heisenberg. The ontology of materialism, that is this idea of the clockwork universe. Our universe is just pieces moving together. Rested upon the illusion that the kind of existence, the direct actuality of the world around us, can be extrapolated into the atomic range. This extrapolation, however, is impossible. Atoms are not things. See, in the clockwork universe, or with our billiard balls, we expected that as we got smaller and smaller and smaller, we would find smaller and smaller little clockwork pieces, or smaller and smaller billiard balls knocking into each other. It turns out that that's not what's happening at all. The things that are down there are nothing like billiard balls or clockwork pieces. They don't bump into each other, for example. They are best described as a probabilistic wave function. A wave function, every particle in the universe. They exist in a state of superposition across the range of this wave function, interacting probabilistically with the probabilistic motion of other wave functions. At the subatomic level, there's no place where I end and the air begins, for example. Then in the instant that a human observes a particle, physicist John von Neumann says, a miracle occurs. The wave function collapses into a material reality. Okay, that was a lot of science. Let me break this down easier. What we actually discovered about the world is that everywhere, at every moment, every particle in the universe is rolling the dice. And every particle in the universe is rolling exactly what it needs to. Every moment, every particle. That is what Einstein could not believe. He could not believe in a world in which the subatomic things are not clockwork, are not causal, and yet somehow the roll of the dice would always come up six. Impossible. That is why Heisenberg wrote these words in his last letter to Einstein before Einstein's death. We can console ourselves that the good Lord God would know the position of the subatomic particles. Thus, he would let the causality principle continue to have validity. In him, all things hold together indeed. Quantum mechanics is standard science now. We use it to build computers and phones. It's the reason your TV doesn't have radio tubes. We know that this is true. We know that the dice are being rolled every moment, and we know that they always land exactly where they need to. Because a lot may be cast in the lap, but its every decision is from the Lord. So that was the easy one. The second reason that you may doubt the goodness and wisdom of God has nothing to do with physics. It's the same reason that Job questioned. Because the events that you've experienced in life make God feel capricious and arbitrary. Maybe you're suffering now. Maybe this is the worst week of your life. I don't know. Or maybe you've just had a lot of low rolls. And if every decision is from the Lord, then the Lord feels like a bully. That's the same thing that Job felt. If that's where you are today, here's two things. First, I'm so sorry. I know that the last thing in the world that you want is some truisms from a preacher about God's plan. So let me give you something that maybe you can feel. There's a moment in Job 19 where Job has been suffering for 16 chapters now, right? And he's on this emotional roller coaster of grief. God is good, God is not, God is good. In one of the hopeful moments, he says this, I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end he will stand on the earth, and after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes, I and not another. How my heart yearns within me. This is a prophetic and spirit-empowered moment for Job, right? Job believes that even after his death, after his flesh is destroyed, yet he will somehow stand on the earth again and see God face to face. There is no reason for Job to believe this, aside from the Holy Spirit. This is one of the few places the Old Testament even speaks of an afterlife more than the shadowy Sheol. But it turns out that Job was right about his Redeemer living, and he was right about him standing on the earth. And so here are some things that God himself, the Redeemer, had to say when he was on the earth. Very truly I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but has crossed over from death to life. Very truly I tell you, a time is coming and has now come when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For the Father has life in himself, and so he has granted the Son also to have life in himself. And he has given him authority to judge, because he is the Son of Man. Do not be amazed at this, for a time is coming when all who are in their graves will hear his voice and come out, and those who have done what is good will rise to live, and those who have done what is evil will rise to be condemned. The God who animates every particle in the universe, moment by moment, knows everything that has ever happened to you, knows everything that you have ever done, and is keeping careful accounts. You know that thing that we all feel God should do if he is in fact just, reward the righteous and punish the wicked? He has promised to do precisely that. If great evil has been done against you, it has not gone unnoticed by God. All sin gets paid for. Either Jesus pays for it on the cross, or they pay for it. Nothing is free. Nothing is forgotten. Not by that God. That is why we are told not to judge, because it is the God who knows every heart motivation, every hormonal imbalance, every genetic variable, and every component that goes into every human decision. He will be the judge and not us. Conversely, if you've been cheated in life, if you have suffered unnecessarily, like Job, God is keeping tabs on every bit of it. And upon your bodily resurrection, you, like Job, will stand before him, and he will repay you much more than what was lost. Again, the words of Jesus. Truly I tell you, at the renewal of all things, when the Son of Man sits on his glorious throne, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone who has left houses or brothers or sisters or father or mother or wife or children or fields for my sake will receive 100 times as much and will inherit eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and many who are last will be first. Jesus says two things here. Even something as valuable as family members will be restored by that God. And 100-fold more, including eternal life. And many who are last, many who have rolled badly time and time again, will be first. God knows what you have suffered. And although it may seem impossible, he promises that with a full knowledge of everything happening in the universe, he is able to make it right. Okay, normally we would do pastor's challenge here. This is the book of Job. Also, it's wisdom literature. It really just doesn't lend itself to pastor's challenge. So we're going to do thoughts to ponder instead. Thoughts to ponder. I'm going to hand this over to Justin at the Takotnu campus. Thanks for joining us, Takotnu. He's going to handle your thoughts to ponder. And here at Raspberry Online, let's ponder some thoughts, okay? Ready to ponder with me? We'll just take these with you over the week. Here's thought number one. God is not a machine. He resists simple explanation or manipulation. Job's three friends are rebuked by God, who says that they spoke wrongly of him. Modern Eliphaz, Bildad, or Zophar might tell you that if you pray the right way, if you have the right amount of faith, if you give the right amount of money, God will do X or Y. God says those people speak wrongly of him. Here's our second thought. Sometimes we get to see the reasons that God had for allowing suffering. Sometimes we don't. I can look back on some experiences of suffering in my life and see how God used it to bring maturity, to create perseverance, character, and hope, etc. You guys know the verse. Other ones, I don't see it. My only option is to trust that God's wisdom is still in operation there, or to not. Third and final thought to ponder. Through Jesus, God has made a way to redeem what has been lost as we put our faith in him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Job believed in the coming of his Redeemer, who would give him a chance for vindication before God. Thousands of years later, that promise was fulfilled. Now we wait for the return of that Redeemer to fulfill his promise to renew all things. So we can put the thoughts to ponder back up here. I'm going to pray for us, and we'll be all done for the day. Okay? Join me in prayer. Father, you are before all things. In you we live and move and have our being, and in you all things hold together. God, your wisdom is too wonderful for us. But caught in this place on the earth, we see through a glass darkly. We have limited perspective. It is very difficult for us to comprehend your wisdom or look into it. Your word says that only the spirit of a man that is within a man knows his mind. And so we're thankful for your Holy Spirit that is within us. Lord, I pray for those among us who are suffering today. I ask that you would send the Holy Spirit to be their comforter. I ask that you would send better friends than Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar. And I ask that you would show up for them, not with a challenge, but with comfort. Lord, help us to be a community of people who are good friends and help others suffer well. Thank you for your faithfulness to our church and all you're doing in our body. You're a good dad, and we love you. Amen.